Hello, Azraf. Can you hear me? Now? Okay, I can hear myself, so it's better. Okay, so this is Piotr, I'm Krzysztof, and we are working Virtus Lab as Rafhausen, and hello to everyone that I don't say hello before. And today, we want to talk about perspective change, a huge Scala project from Tooling Perspective. You're probably a little bit interested in what we want to talk about. So, first of all, I will show you the plan. So. At first, we will tell you about what tooling are we like creating, as much as we can say. Then we can like share two ideas, like two experience from our work. I mean, about stability and support, basically. I mean, they're doing the support. So, just to warn you, this is not a presentation about SBT, CI jobs, any or the IDE. This is a presentation about the experience, the sum of experience that come from providing a tooling that integrate all of this stuff. I mean, Piotr will say more about that. I don't want to like take his job about this. So why do we need such tooling? Why do we need something that integrates all these parts? Why do we just tell developers, okay, this is like CI, this is like, there is an IDE that you can set up, and here is a code. Go for it, like play with it. Because this is a story how we provide the tooling for the user that using not like Scala, but using more the DSL that's created in Scala. So there are not primarily developers, they are more like analytics, not that's deeply technical guys. And also this is a story about how tooling is failing and how this one integrated tool can fix even for like experienced developer. All this stuff. Okay, so now I pass mic to the Piotr and he will tell you more what is exactly this big tool.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so first of all, so we'll be on the same page. I want to explain what we mean by tooling because this is quite a broad term. So when I will say tooling, I mean basically everything which you can imagine, which means from the build scripts and the build system like SBT, Gradle, whatever, Maven, whatever you can imagine, to the IDEs, Eclipse, IntelliJ, that's actually two IDEs which were supporting for the long time together. Some libraries, programs which are part of the ecosystem, like some, I don't know, debuggers, profilers, that kind of stuff. CIs and caches which support building. So basically, not only tools itself, but everything around that. So that's what I mean by tooling. Yes, so everything. What is really our situation and what we need to provide? So we need to support a lot of repositories at the same time, but by a lot I mean few dozens, maybe over 100 in total, because there are some repositories, forks, other branches, sometimes completely different code bases. And they are quite different sometimes, but we want to keep some framework and some structure which will allow us to reuse as much of the full infrastructure as we can. So we don't let to go every project its own way. We want to provide some structure so we can plug into and provide a lot of things in a uniform way. So this also means that things like IDE integration, plugins for build system, everything like that is automatically provided as a part of the environment, and you can set up everything with basically one command and you are ready to go. So yes, so I will tell you a bit about the problems which we see during day-to-day work, and I will try to talk a bit about the solutions if we have any. So hopefully if you will be in the situation like we are today, and you will need to provide tooling for that big project at some point, you will have some head start. And possibly also, if you are tool developers, then developing these tools, you will have that kind of problems in mind, and you will make all life easier by including some assumptions from the day one. And yeah, you will see what I mean when we continue. So the first problem which I want to talk about is, as I mentioned, we have a lot of repositories, a lot of code bases, and sometimes different users and different teams are also on the different forks of the same repository or on different commits going into some are, for example, lagging 1 month before after some other team. And we need to provide this basically the same tooling for all that workspaces. And you need to include things like, for example, Scala version can change in some repository at some point of time. The upgrade of the IDEs happens, project structure change, and so on. And even every user can have multiple of that workspaces, even a few dozen of the workspaces at the same machine. And sometimes some users need to work at multiple of that workspaces at the same time. So you cannot really, I don't know, create Docker image or some virtual machine and just load that. There is few reasons for that. One is that you need a lot of them. And second reason is that sometimes even at the same workspace, being the one developer, you need to go back and forth, for example, checking out some commit from the past. Your tooling version, which is actually committed into the repository, can change. And then the whole ecosystem must be smart enough that it will notice, OK, tooling version need to change. I need to reset everything which need to be reset, go back, install proper version of the ID, regenerate project structure, and upgrade everything which need to upgrade it. So as you can see on the image, we have different tooling versions, the boxes at the top. And then every repository can have different version of the tooling. Even this can change even per commit, per branch. So basically, and you can get forward with the tooling versioning, but you can get also backward. For example, we did something wrong. We have some regression, and we're saying, okay, this release was failure. We need to roll back quickly, so we can change the version of the tooling to the previous one, so the users can work until we'll fix it properly. So that's basically a requirement. And there is, as I mentioned before, there is a few problems with that, because when the tooling version can change, because we are providing everything as the unified package, there is multiple actions which need to be taken into account. Because if you upgrade the code base and the tooling version, what can happen? You can have the upgrade of the IDE. Your project files, grade SBT build files or Gradle files, could change. Some modules could be added, some modules could be removed. Compilation flags need to be changed. So we need to regenerate project structure because we don't committing the IDE files into the repository. It's everything is generated based on the build system files. So some configs can change. Basically, a lot of things need to be updated, but not all of them at the same time. So we don't want to throw everything every time and start from scratch. And there are good reasons for that, because a lot of users have some own tweaks for the IDE settings or some local changes. You don't want to force user every time to wait 1 hour to regenerate everything, generate the caches in the ID, and so on. Because this takes time, and users easily get upset if they need to wait. So if you don't need to make them wait, you doesn't. So you need to be smart about that. You need to know which kind of action you should do depends on what changes. So you need to this kind of smart, clean, and restore actions which have different granularity. Next problem is that basically IDEs are not really designed to support that kind of requirements which I told you previously. As I said, we are generating the project files based on the build definition, and theoretically, IDEs like IntelliJ have support both from Gradle and SBT, so you can just set, okay, use this SBT file, voila, set up the IDE. Except that it doesn't work for a project like we have, because if you have big enough project, then you probably have already own fork of the SBT, some plugins to it, which IDE developers didn't thought about, and you cannot even change the version of SBT inside the IDE, I mean the local, for example, point to the local jar, because no one thought that it would be needed. And I can tell you that in our case, both Gradle and SBT doesn't work, I mean automatic integration, so you need to do something else about that. So, in theory, the best solution would be to fix the integration and make it work. In practice, the solution which you are forced to use in most cases when you have limited time and resources is to hack over these problems until you will be able to solve, at least until you will be able to solve them properly, and that we are doing right now. But this also sometimes there is not even perfect solution for the problem. Like, let's consider the project structure regeneration. We can theoretically discover that, okay, SBT or Gradle file changed in some of the projects. So we probably need to regenerate project structure. But maybe there was some change, but you don't know if this change really causes project structure change or compiler flags. Maybe it doesn't matter for the IDE. Maybe you don't need to regenerate this project. And if you basically can bring change to the project structure every time when you do the pull. And if you will force user to regenerate whole project structure and update the caches and so on after every pull, then some users will say, that's not gonna happen, that doesn't work, I don't like that. So there is always trade-off. We can do the things automatically and ensure that it will be correct, but at the same time we cannot do it in the way which will be fast and will satisfy every user. So what we are doing right now is to let user decide. So we just provide some actions inside the IDE so you can upgrade everything with one click, but you need to decide that, okay, I did big pull from the code base, probably something changed, okay, regenerate. Or if you see it doesn't work, something doesn't compile, I will regenerate. Or I break something, project structure is broken, I regenerate. And actually that kind of safety actions which you can clean, I will tell, Krzysiek will tell more about that later, that kind of clean actions with different granularity are also very important in that kind of project. You also have other requirements which are not met by the IDE. So I will tell you shortly about a few of them. So let's imagine a situation when you have a compiler plugin as the part of your project structure, and you are building it and then using it for the other project. So actually no Eclipse, no IntelliJ support that kind of scenario. You can build it, but if it's part of the build, you cannot at the same time use it to build other modules. So you need to hack around it. In our case, we are making custom builders to IntelliJ and Eclipse basically the same, which first at the phase of the sources translation build the plugin, and then you just proceed normally. And there is a lot of cases like that, like support for presentation compiler. IntelliJ doesn't support macros and compiler plugins in the presentation compiler, so every time you do something custom and complicated, you are on your own. Recently they added the API so you can code your own support for presentation compiler, and that's what we are doing basically, but it of course you need additional work to keep everything in sync. And there are other things like that. So you need to add a lot of work to make it really working. Next problem. To put this into perspective, this slide, I'm not talking about projects which compiles 5 minutes or 10 minutes. We are talking about project which compiles 1 hour, let's say, more or less. So in that cases, because I don't have problem waiting 5 minutes for compilation, if some people are saying that it's long in Scala, it's not. I have problem waiting 1 hour, and especially if after 50 minutes incremental compilers go south, and I need to recompile again, so it's already 2 hours. And we are trying to somehow overcome that problems, and there are two possible, well, there's probably more possible solutions, but two comes to my mind from the background in C++. One is some distributed compilation, but unlucky there is nothing like that in Scala, and I don't think there will be any soon, because it's a really complicated problem. And second problem, which is easier to do, at least to some extent, are caching the built output, like the jars on the CI, and then use them as the part of your build. Because if you have a few hundred projects, then there is good chance that you are don't editing a few hundred of them at the same time. This is okay, so we have a few hundred projects in one repository. So you're mostly editing one, two, maybe three. You don't care about the rest. If you are editing only leaf projects, then most of the time you don't need to recompile anything, only these projects. And if it's built from, let's say you do big pool or it's first setup of the repository, you don't really need to wait 1 or 2 hours to set up everything, because probably someone before, and CI for sure, built this before. So why not to reuse the resources? And that's what we are trying to do. There's actually two different approaches which you can use here, probably more, two which we are thinking about, and one we are using right now. One is just using the jars from the CI, so user can define, okay, this project I care about, this and this, and that ones, no, there should be defaults. And you can actually also auto-discover this, because you can check using, for example, Git, which project really changed, which not. And for the one which doesn't change compared to the main repository, you can just download the jars. For rest, you just use normal compilation from the IDE and from the command line. So this actually works, kind of. There are some problems, obviously, but there are also no signs of this approach. Because, again, you need to code custom support for both IDE and command line builds, because actually existing tools don't have any, I don't know any plugin which allow you to do that kind of things automatically, for example, in SBT. You could theoretically use, for example, you could use IV artifacts which would be generated by CI, but if you have cache miss, then build will fail, and we don't want to do that. So if it's not on the CI, then you need to build it manually, so you need some fallback mechanisms. And on the IDE side, there is the same story, but you need to have like separate implementation. And also, if you have big project and change only one file, you don't really want to rebuild it for 15 minutes if the change is very small. But you, with this approach, you cannot avoid that. So there is other idea, which is not tested in production yet. But you can generate the same cache, but using SBT with name hashing enabled. And basically do all the work, all the work by SBT. So when you discover that, when you check out the code, you check your Git hash, check the CI, get the closest possible version. You don't need to have exact hit here. Get the closest version, and then SBT should discover, okay, this project, this file changed, let's do incremental compilation. This is great in theory, solves a lot of the problems with previous approach, then it's only one problem, because if the SBT won't work reliable, and in our code base sometimes it doesn't, then you can get two situations, it compiles too small, or it recompiles too small and you have not updated the files, or it recompiles too much and you need to wait more than you should. And I think we had both of the situations with our code base. Especially dangerous one is if it compiles too small, because then you have wrong files or not working programs, and you need to recompile everything to get to the proper version, because compiler is basically lost. So until this will be properly solved, at least the known cases, because we already reproduced a few of them and fixing them already, we cannot really safely go with this approach, although theoretically there should be some benefits. Next problem, tooling should be really resistant to random failures. Because as you can see, we have really huge code base. This is like over 1 million lines of codes and literally hundreds of developers. And I can tell you, IDEs are failing every single day. I mean, there is no day without few reports of something. Something failed for me, incremental compiler is broken, Eclipse crashed and cannot be. And Eclipse actually, when it's crashing, it's not like crashed and restarted. Sometimes it crashed and it's done. You need to just wipe out everything and go from scratch. In IntelliJ, it's better because it's only incremental compiler, so you need to wipe out the caches. But it's still a bit better. It's still a bit faster. So what do we do about that? There is sometimes not a lot to do, which you can do yourself because you are relying on the external tools. So we cannot fix every single one of them, especially that sometimes these failures are really hard to reproduce. If someone compiles 1 million of 1 million lines of the code and it fails after 39 minutes, and well, it fails, but he compiles it again and it works, then you can imagine that reproduction sometimes is hard. So when we cannot solve the problem immediately, what we can do is report the problem, get as much information as we can, and recover. So Krzysiek will be telling more about that in a minute, but what we are doing is basically two things. One thing is reporting, which we have some more extensive tool to report and allowing us to reproduce easier all the problems. But second thing which we do is providing the ability to recreate workspace on multiple granularity levels. So if you know that cache is broken, you can clean the cache. If you know that everything is broken or you are you lost all the hope to restore workspace, you can just wipe out everything. If you are already tired of trying everything else and you are going home, you can say, okay, I want to have this repository working tomorrow morning and with all the code built and everything working, and you can just run one command and it must work next day morning. And actually, I think this was one. This sounds stupid, but I think this was one of the most valuable new features which users said they are like it. They love it. I wouldn't say, but yeah. I think the last problem which I want to talk about is that tools itself are not enough sometimes in case of Scala, because we don't have an advanced enough tools. Sometimes I'm not even sure if it's easily possible to do. But to some extent, good practices and discipline can help us in that cases. Mostly I'm talking about the incremental compilation and the overall compilation speed. So there are a few things which you probably know about, and there are like obvious things. And if you have projects which have a few dozen of classes or which compiles 5 minutes, really you don't need to care and you don't care. But if you have a huge code base and many developers and you don't care at the beginning, then don't care later because you, well, that's the habit, then at the end it's too late. So there are some things which you can do to reduce incremental compilation speed and the overall complexity of work which compiler need to do, but better start from the beginning. Of course, there could be some automated tools to do that, like two things which comes to my mind is automatic type insertion, which we even talked recently in the firm, and which this probably could be done, but so far there is no tool for that which can do this reliable for the whole code base. And for example, second thing which comes to mind could be something which reduce the scope of implicit, but that I think that would be a much more complicated thing. So until this, the tools like that are here, you can probably be much safer doing this manually, remembering about this, looking into that kind of things during the code review and having good standards from the very beginning, because otherwise you will be really, really lost. And I think I will give the microphone to Krzysiek right now, which will tell you more about a few specifics.
Do you have any question about that part? Okay, so we can maybe
switch.
Come to the question later. Okay.
There's one.
Okay.
Do you really have a project with one million of lines of code?
I don't count it exactly, but I expect
it was
even more.
It was more. Yeah, I counted that once. It was more. A bit more.
So why?
Actually, there is good answer, but I cannot tell you why, because this is connected with the specific of the project, which is too internal to disclose it here. I know it sounds like, I knew that this question will come, but I didn't figure out an intelligent answer it would be other than that. So.
Basically, it was smaller, but when it was merged, let's say, it started to work better.
Well, actually we had other design in past, so it was multiple of smaller projects, but there was reason why power users wanted to have it like that, and it was specifically changed from multiple smaller repositories to this big one. But.
And we don't think this is like the biggest problem here. Okay. If I ask you right now, what is more important, the IDE to be fast or tooling to be fast or stable? Like most of you will probably answer fast. But if you have like big projects, all what like our managers, what all our users want is stability. Stability is key to successful tooling. And all of us sometimes forget about that. Because if you're creating a tooling, you probably deal with like small workspaces. You don't see these big projects. You are like experienced. You know the tooling, and you know how to recover because you write it. And this also same for the developers that like working really to like Scala core or on some like high-end Scala projects. They know what was going on and they know how to recover because, for example, they understand error messages. But there is not all Scala developers can do that. So that is why I want to talk here about stability. And I think that stability starts with recovery. Because as Piotr said before, that there is no tool in the earth that will never break. And in our case, all tools that try, I mean, every one of them will break, breaks at some point. You say IntelliJ is best. Okay, it's working fast. We have like files. I want to show you, but I can't. Where it's frozen because it's like too complicated and many more things like that. So there's like, from our perspective, there's like no tool that will never break. So, and even if tools breaks once a year, if you have like, let's say over 300 workspaces, it means it will break every day. So if scale is big enough, even the best tooling have problems. So let's come to the situation from, because we are more or less also supporting because that our tooling. Because if you like leave tool to leave it again and don't like get feedback from user, it's like not a valuable tool. So if you're creating a library tool, anything, listen to your user. There's like big, a lot of ideas come from them. So the situation here is someone got the exception from the compiler. Not like problem in the compilation, exception that compiler broke. And he tried like compile, recompile, but didn't help. Okay, we know the problem because we debugged it before, but the only solution that we can give to that user at this moment was to rebuild everything from scratch. And user waste an initial like before our help, like 10 minutes or 20 minutes or half an hour trying to recompile this given single project. It fails, and the exception was totally that user cannot understand that the exception. Even I can't, because it was totally unrelated to the problem that was really underneath. So we advise the full build. It takes like 30 minutes, but it works. Tooling is working fine, but user lost about an hour of his life. And if there's like a deadline nearby, it's like a lot of time. So the problem was really simple. I mean, IntelliJ. And underneath, to even you do the compile, it's basically almost like cleaning Eclipse. Cleaning the output of the compilation, and this is based on cache. And cache, even the best one, sometimes get corrupted. It was the case. Cache was simply corrupted. So
The problem, you should probably ask me, okay, why I'm talking about this? I should like report it to JetBrains, like to know, okay, there's a problem, find a reproduction. But come on, random cache corruptions is not simple to find, like when it happened, why it happened, because you don't know when cache got corrupted. You know that something is wrong when you see the results. It can be like 10 minutes after cache got corrupted. So in such situation, it's really hard to debug, and the only solution that we can give to the user is recovery strategy. That is why recovery is so important. Of course, there is a what we call nuclear recovery, the tool that Piotr mentioned about the option to rebuild, recreate all the workspace. There was a proposal to call it Nuke, and it was really close to be called like that, the official project for a big company, but some high manager said no, it should be like serious. So yeah, come back to the problem. So this full like nuclear recovery is not enough because it takes time. Nukes are expensive. I mean, okay, if user compiles something and this like one project is broken, or in case of Eclipse, one cache is broken, you have to set up all the workspace again, Dolan, everything, or recompile the workspace. It's like it's 1 hour lost. It's like a lot of time, especially under deadline pressure. So can we do better? What I want and what's like good idea in such situation is a quick and precise recovery strategy. So if there is like a cache, there should be option to clean that cache. If one project is failing, there should be option to recompile only one project. And in the mentioned case, the fix that we created was really simple. We just introduced clean button to IntelliJ that basically cleans all the classes. No cache was used. Yeah, it was fixed. Yeah, it was a recovery strategy. Yeah, and it works. It helped a lot of users, and right now there's a problem. User just clean the output, everything works fine. And maybe we can like debug what is really wrong and try to fix that. But in our case, it's like it's enough. And we can provide that because, as Piotr said before, we can't fix all the tooling because there's outside. There is a problem to build a tool. I will mention that later in the end of the presentation. So again, why this is so important? It's the feel of the stability that matter in the end of the day. If there is like, okay, if user breaks every day for 10 minutes and you can spend, I don't know, another 10 minutes to fix that, you lose like, let's say, an hour a week. But if user know that it can fix his workspace in 10 minutes or 5 minutes, he feel like secure because, okay, there is I have like deadline, but IDE will broke, but 10 minutes later I can work again. But if IDE will break once a week or once in 2 weeks, but you have to spend like hour or two to recreate that IDE, then if it happened under the deadline pressure, you will surely get like answer, oh, this is crappy tools, I don't want to use them in 90s. We got like the message on email list like, in 90s there was better tooling than now. Why we are 20 years before the world? Because of that, because of this, once or twice a week, it broke and you need an hour. That is why, for the sake of the feel of the stability, you have to be able to recover quickly. Because like I mentioned before, there is no tooling that will never broke. There is another topic. I should like put the slides from Piotr from the beginning. I mean, if something broke, you have to report and recover. I mentioned recover, and I want to talk about the reporting. So when you provide this recovery strategy, but this happens often, you want to fix that problem. But to fix the problem, you need reproduction. And right now, this is a story how to help us to find the reproductions for the problems. This again, come back. It's broke. Can I give another? Can you hear me? Okay, so let's come back to the another like usual mail on the support mailing list. Okay, user changed something in the leaf, one of the leaf project, compile everything, no problem, then try to run application, and IDE starts to build everything from scratch. It was IntelliJ. So we are, as usual, asking about, because this comes a serious problem, we see like multiple times and finally want to know why. All the information that we can get, and user usually replies where I can get that information. Even if you ask what commit are you on, how to get the commit hash. So there's also this kinds of user because they never use like Git from the command line, for example. And in the end,
because of the, all the threads going on, user forgot it removes the workspaces and stuff like that. The answer was, sorry, I cannot reproduce your problem. And I waste like a few hours talking with user, but okay, I'm here to do that. But the second problem is that user like waste another a few hours, and this is a bigger problem. So how to address that? As I mentioned, this problem was supported multiple times, and multiple hours later, multiple mail like that later, I finally find a problem. And this is a reproduction in IntelliJ. Don't worry, it is reported, it is fixed right now. But a response I got from JetBrain was, how you ever like come that dude, this will break everything. And if you, because, and I think in the smaller workspaces, no one will care about that. Because if, okay, once in a while, code will compile another minute more, who cares? But if there's like 1 hour of compilation time, everybody starts like now caring. So how to find the reproduction? Because without reproduction, I can't even say what is like broken. I can like, because, and reproductions are important, and it's because it's the problem of the tooling that of the so many moving parts are as RDEs or incremental compilers is so random and so small details matter. There is an example, another problem in IntelliJ, it was a problem, let's say problem, because this is a tool mentioned by Piotr earlier about introducing support for compiler macro API basically. And we find the reproduction and send it to JetBrains, and we got, okay, we cannot reproduce your problem, even with the reproduction. So we look at the code they tried, and it seems that this was the missing part. I mean, they just add in one place string at not type. That was obvious from the point of view of user, and it start and it failed the build. And it showed that the reproduction and the problem with the such complicated tooling of such complicated code is that every single detail, the detail matter. And for the compiler, for the IDE, we cannot create enough like unit tests or integration tests because there's like too many options to cover. So how to find these reproductions? Because this is like the first step to solve the problem. In that mentioned case, I spent like, let's say, a week finding the reproduction. When I got a repeatable reproduction, I spent like 4 hours looking for the problems. And what I got, and I know what was wrong, I spent like 2 hours creating minimal. So, and probably JetBrains spends like 2 days fixing the problem. So we see what's like the biggest problem here. If you can, if you will able to find the reproduction quickly, you can save the problems. Fix the problem more faster. And most of the tooling this is taken from SBT. When you report the problem, they ask you for three things. I mean, step, problems, and expectation. I mean, the expectation is the simplest one to create to provide problem. Good. Sometimes it's really hard to describe problem, but create the steps. I mean, reproduction for that problem. This is the biggest problem. Many problems in one sentence, I think. Okay, so I mentioned about tooling, but in the end, even if you have like the best tools, it always ends in the manual searching for the reproduction, because okay there's a problem that are easy that everybody can spot, but they are usually fixed on the spot on the creator of the tool. So in the end, you have to spend your time searching for reproduction. So the question is, how to reduce the time doing that? Because trust me, playing with IDE like a monkey is not the most fun part of the job, but it's required to fix the problems. So first idea that comes to mind, and I think a lot of tools, example IntelliJ using that, is error reports. So what error report is basically from user perspective, it just put a short description of the problem, click one button, and information is sent, and with that, it comes like as many information as possible. Of course, as many information as is legally possible to send, because nobody wants to send non-public code to somebody else. You cannot also like send multiple information that might be required, but it's not legally possible. But from developer point of view, it's like really powerful if you're talking about reproductions, because it's not like it gives you the information what was wrong. It gives you like the most valuable information. I mean, where to start. Like a version. Information about in which version is broken. It's like
super important. Without that, you cannot, because if you have like five versions of your tool, and tool covers like five places, and there is like 1,000 possible like ways that it can go, it's like going exponentially to the up. So if you can reduce like this five version to one, and like one repository, one kind of code, the scope of for the search is much smaller. And for the error reports, we start even thinking about like providing this, develop this tool even further. So provide tags for the problems, provide the script reproduction, giving the user ability to like create a snapshot, and just to like categorize the problems. And even in the end, we plan at some point to create that each error report contains a script that I can like run on my computer and set up a workspace. So this will help me to reduce the time for the reproduction like by 5 hours per problem. And this like from problems that is reported multiple times, this means like a lot. Another idea, like this going even further, is statistic gathering. But so basically we plan to get all the, at the start, all the problems for ID, for our tooling. And then looking at the problems, we can see what's going on in the workspace. We don't have enough data to say about the results of that because it was like introduced like a month ago, probably. But I hope this will like pay off. Another category of tool that is mostly using by the error reports is self-diagnostic tools. I mean, that of detection from IntelliJ. If your main thread in IntelliJ like froze for a while, IntelliJ automatically takes the thread dumps. It's like, and then with the reports, okay, my integer go like slow. You look at that thread dumps and you know where it's like slow. So the second part, I mean the tweaks in Scalaide, and this is not probably good a name for that. But what I mean here is, if you have like job running on the pool, and you the thread dump is basically like the only thing that you can get at some point. So please provide and as many information in the thread name as possible, because then you got a thread dump. Then you can see, okay, there's not like some random code like from random classes, but it's name. Okay, compilation of project, I don't know, A is going on. And you see, okay, that's A is failing. And in thread dumps, the thread dumps, the only value that is printed is probably is the thread name. So maybe it's worth to add the information what's going on inside. And from the incremental compiler field, I mean, SBT allows to track the changes for the that caused the compilation, and having that, it's much easier to find why the compilation started again, because you know what was changed and what was compiled and what was compiled in the end. So if you create like any tools, think about that. If there is like some place when you can put the diagnostic tool, like self-diagnostic tool, do that, please. But beware, this causing a problems. I mean, we face the problem with SBT API changes tracking. It just broke the compilation from the more complicated time. We created a tool that detects the deadlocks in our jobs. And basically, when we are hit by live locks multiple times, we just want to stop the compilation and set the user that's fixed. This is basically a fast recovery strategy. But in one, and there was like a amount of timeout. And at some points, the jobs are starting to grow like twice the time of what the job was taken to be done, and this deadlock detection just breaks this job, and it was like we got a lot of yelling about that from the support list, and well, of course time losses on like this disk space used for the data, it also have to be like considered when create that. Okay, so this is like basically all about the reporting and looking for reproduction. And now in the end, because this is the last slide probably, we want to ask you, like, because I hope I see at the future or current tool developers. I mean, please give us a possibility to log as much as possible. Not by default, but if you like see there's a problem somewhere, we can turn on the logging and see what's going on the user workspaces. Is like super important. Another thing, allow us to easily connect with the debugger if there's like multiple JVMs running on. IntelliJ has like this great option that you can provide a port to the debugger, and each JVM that is started for the incremental compiler is waiting for the debugger connection before it starts doing anything. If I don't have that, I don't think I will be able to find the problem mentioned before. Another thing, releases, please tag your releases so I can, if I have a problem with your tooling, I know what source code can be was used to compile that tooling, because I don't think that any documentation on the world is like enough to find the problem. Source code is the best documentation, but if I don't get the good source code for the tool, I can't debug it. And the last, but probably the most important, please don't depend on snapshots in your build. Because half hour later, I have to like rebuild your tool to like apply some fixes, and I can't do that because there was a snapshot use, and it got deleted after like week after the tool was released. And for the developers, okay, there's no problem, I can build it because you got it in your cache. From our perspective, there was every time like new guys joining our team, he finds at least one dependency that is broken because all of us got this in the cache, and he not. So there's like four simple things, but really it will help for us, like the guys that have to integrate your tooling. So I pass it to Piotr, like some last words, probably.
Yeah. So I guess if you would do statistical analysis of OTOG, then probably 50% of the words was the word problem. The next 30% was recovery, and the last 20% was some random words. But I think what you should come out with from this talk is some slightly changed of mindset. So we will be aware of the problems which we touch every day and which bug us all the time, and about which sometimes many people doesn't think when they start developing their tools, because mostly you start many products and project starts at the hobby project. No one think about the scale. No one think what will happen if it will fail. It will fail, then it will fail. There will be exception thrown, and someone will think about this later, or maybe not. So actually, if we want the ecosystem to be more mature and bigger companies to start using it, and we are thinking about Scala as the platform for building real world products, then we also need to start thinking about maturing ecosystem and maturing the tools. And problem handling, recovery strategies, and all the things which we talk about are definitely part of that whole problem. No, I don't want to use this word anymore. So I hope you will get a bit different picture than you have doing everyday development, and when you will next create some tool, you will keep in my mind at least part of this presentation. Thank you.
So when we meet next year, we can see that's like it was put to use, and I can say, okay, this and this tool, like apply our rules, and thank you for that. So let's hope we will set that for every tool we are using. Do you got any questions for us?
Git słyszę, ale to no to się nie
rzesz. I'd like to ask if you, for the matter, use Git subrepositories in your project, and if so, does it pose any problem for the tooling for the topic at hand?
We do not. I think there was some discussions about that, if we should or not. But I think if you have, I think even in the official documentation of the Git, they are saying that if you are using submodules, you need to know what we are doing, and it doesn't cover all the cases which we need to support. So, final decision was to not to use them. We have just one big unified code base.
And especially that having big Git repository, in our case, it causes only like maybe slightly longer time for workspace creation. All the problem with scale, there's like no solution for that, because in the end you have to like everything set up on that disk to build it. So it's
this like idea, but there was like it's not the, like a silver bullet for our problem.
Plus, this is not the next thing which I want to debug if something will break. Yeah, exactly. If we don't need to do that, then we rather don't. Any more questions? Then I think, thank you.
Thank you.
So actually, this was the last presentation for the whole 2 days, for the whole conference. I hope you enjoyed it. It has been a long 2 days. I understand that. I can see that also. So that's true. But I hope the presentation and the topic of the conference was pretty different than for the other conferences, and that you've actually liked it and took some value out of it. Hopefully we will meet next year for the next edition of this type of conference with a bigger audience, maybe the next real life example.